you know, how long did it take for you to do this? I mean, you know, was it like all in a row, or was like?
No, actually, I've been working on it for maybe 30 years. From the 70s when I got interested in the whole thing and was sort of turned off by some of the inaccuracies in Wiccan history, and I decided I would go back and find out where everything came from. I actually took it all the way back to the Egyptians and Greeks, but for this particular focus, I decided to look into what actually happened in England and concentrated on that area, and then decided to narrow it down to a controllable period of, you know, 1550 to 1900.
Yes, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, we're talking with Jim Baker, the author of The Cunning Man's Handbook, and this is an edition for our beloved, again, Avalonia Books, The Practice of English Folk Magic, 1550 to 900s. And you were talking to me, saying to me that this took, it's a product of 30 years of research, right?
Yeah.
And it's really incredible. Now, you do have other books that people sometimes they don't really know. One of them is called Plymouth. And 2012, right? And then you'll have also another one, Plymouth, Labor and Leisure. And you also have another one, which is a little bit more recent, also Thanksgiving, Revisiting New England. I think that the 2012 one is Plymouth, Labor and Leisure, and then 2010 you did the Thanksgiving one, right?
Yes. The two Plymouth books are basically pictures. I've always been fascinated with what Plymouth used to look like because it was changing during my own lifetime.
Yes.
When I was young, it looked very much the way it had in the late 19th century. And then when I had urban renewal take out a whole bunch of Plymouth, I noticed the loss, and having grown up in that neighborhood. And so I went down to Pilgrim Hall, look at their old pictures, and ended up identifying and categorizing about 4,000 photos. So I got very familiar with the pictures of Plymouth, and those books are what it used to look like.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Now let's look at this fantastic book. I mean, this is a big book, Jim. It's a big book. No wonder 30 years, right, of work in this. And the thing that, you know, let me just ask the question again. Why did you decided to write this? What was really the trigger here for you to get into this research?
Well, there were a couple of them. The first one was, of course, when I'd learned that Wiccan history wasn't what I had thought it was, I felt annoyed for being tricked, you might say, and then decided, well, what was the real history? So I decided to do that. And I'd originally hoped, in a sort of vague way, doing research while I was doing research for my job elsewhere at the plantation, by looking up these things in libraries in England and things like that, that I would do a history of the Cunning Folk altogether. But I didn't. And then Ronald Hutton and Owen Davies came along and did the history that I had originally thought of writing vaguely. And so I thought, well, I'll make a contribution that I can. The thing about most of the books, they tell you that people did this, people did that, but they don't explain exactly what it was. They just reference it. And I thought, years ago, in fact, it was 1963, I bought a book called Ritual Magic by E.M. Butler. And Elizabeth Butler had done, you know, a compilation of things. And I was very annoyed with it because she'd just do little short things and you couldn't tell how they tied together. And you couldn't really recreate anything from it. It was a good historical study, but it's like it was incomplete. And so what I decided to do was to provide full length, and they are full, examples of everything I was talking about. And that's what bulked up the book.
Yeah. Now, there is a question. So that was the question, you know, that you actually make this in the introduction, which is, you know, you said, you know, what have been the magical practices of the British populace? And this was, you know, really your main. But there is another thing here, right, that we, and I'm sure that you find this out when you did your research, there's a whole lot of oral tradition that was not put down.
Yes, yes. Oral tradition fades. In fact, that's one of the weaknesses of oral tradition. People rely on it historically, but after about two or three generations, in other words, out of living memory, people have an inevitable tendency to edit it into what they think is now the right way to say it. And so the original is lost, and it's revised, continually revised, so that oral traditions of things going way back, except for a few things like genealogies, are unreliable and more or less reflect the needs and interests of the people of any particular time, rather than all the way back to, you know, the original, whatever that might have been.
Yeah, yeah. Now, you talk about habitus,
yeah.
And you talk about, you know, you take this concept of habitus, which I'm going to ask you what it is so that you can define so that we know what it is, but you talk about habitus that was characteristic of the early modern European era, and that was actually Christian. So what is this habitus that permeates all of this history of the cunning men?
Well, a habitus is like your whole internal and external culture. It's what you grow up in, how you understand the world, how you look at things. Every culture has its own, and actually every period probably has its own. It's a term that Bourdieu, the French writer, came up with, or at least popularized. And it really expresses almost the bounds of thinking. You can't think outside your habitus. A good example is every time, say, back in the 1950s and 60s, they wanted to show the future. It was full of planes flying everywhere and rocket ships and things like that. And a few years later, it looked so outdated because they were in their habitus. They couldn't see what the real future was. They could only understand what the future looked like to them in their own conception. And so a habitus is always very limiting. It makes things, it puts things in a certain way, and you can't think outside that box. It simply is not possible.
Can we talk about Jules Verne and how he would be outside of his own habitus at the time?
Yes, Verne, of course, tried. He and H.G. Wells were probably the
yes.
two that were most successful in
yeah.
looking at the evidence and yet trying to go beyond it. But they still
yeah.
worked in what was known to them at their time.
Right.
And
yeah,
although
true,
they predicted yeah. things, all those things were in potential visible in their own culture. They never
mm-hmm.
went outside of it, but they did understand the culture well enough to know how it might proceed.
Yeah, yeah. Now, we talk about the cunning men, and of course this is the Cunning Men's Handbook, and did this book have any other title? Was this it all along?
Actually, I had an earlier title. I can't remember what it was right now, but it's really, I decided because of the
yeah.
long extracts, it could the things that could actually be used if anybody took the trouble to do so.
Yes.
And so I thought,
yeah.
well, a handbook is a good way to explain it. These are the
yeah.
texts that these people
yeah,
worked
yeah.
with, and it shows how they did things, and it explains their habitus as best possible.
Yeah.
And I do have a section where I try to interpret how they thought it might work. It's because it's never explicit. And I needed it explicit in my own mind before I could examine the thing. So that I put together. And that, you know, is purely my own way of looking at things.
Mm-mm.
But the rest of it is based on historical record. I don't go outside the record because outside the record is not available to us.
That's right, yeah, yeah. Now, you talk about the habitus of the early modern Europeans. You also talk about that this habitus was actually Christian, or rather Abrahamic,
yeah.
And there was this filter, and this Abrahamic filter that would, you know, be inserted into anything that would be, you know, Christianity, Judaism, Islam, and all of that, that would permeate across the board all of the things that we do, they would do. And we see this, you know, in many, many times, you know, sometimes people call it, I don't know, traditional witchcraft or whatever they call it, or indigenous, you know, practices, or autochthonous, you know, practices of people. They are still today very much permeated by the major religion of their own countries. And I'm talking about, for instance, what I know, which is Portugal. You still today have cunning women talking and doing things, you know, in countries like this, also very much into their own habitus of Christianity, or in this case, Catholicism, which is basically the religion in Portugal. Could you see here, and I think that you can sometimes, what was at the time the pagan vein of this and the Christian vein on top of it, or that layer?
Well, it's not really two veins. That's the thing. Christianity had swept in, and over 1,000 years, it had re-explained everything in its own terms. Mm-hmm. And although they did have the, you know, and more as the time went on, texts that came from Greece and Rome, the Arabs brought them up to modern date, and then they were taken up in back in Spain and Portugal in the early years. Mm-hmm. And but still, it's like I have a simile in there somewhere, that if you take all these elements and build them together like you would build a building, and you took the stones from an ancient temple and you built a Christian church, you could say that the pieces were pagan, but the church they built, it makes them no longer pagan. They're not recognized as outside or separate. It's all forced into the habitus or current thinking. And by 1550, there was nothing that was recognized as being outside of this. They had managed to get everything, classical culture, from the Greeks, for example, they made it into a precursor of Christianity, the Prisca Theologia, the original religion they thought before Christianity came along, and Judaism was just a little piece of the picture. But since this was supposed to explain the entire world, it had to cover the entire world. All covered, of course, was Europe. It didn't cover Asia or India or anything like that, and where different habituses flourished. And yet, because Christianity spoke to all reality had to be forced into this pattern.
Yeah, I understand, yeah. Now, you begin your book, and you know, I must say that the book is very well organized, you know, it's just very, very good. You begin to, the first thing that you do, and it's obviously, you know, it's one of the first things that you do, chapter 3, you say, okay, let's just look at this and understand the cunning folk. Who were they, and how they actually, you know, in the world, I mean, not only here, but in the world. Who were the cunning folk, and do we have still cunning folk today, you think?
Not in the same sense, because they were working with something that they had inherited, and it was pretty well constructed around their way of viewing the world. It had been more or less unchanged up until the time you hit the Enlightenment and, after the Reformation. And so the people that were working as cunning folk, if you take the term strictly, it's people who work in the old system. And then it changed, as I do in my little short thing about the evolution of occultism, which comes out of this, of course. But by coming out, it completely transforms it. And so there are definitely people who are still working with the old systems, mostly in the powwows in Pennsylvania or the, though it has changed commercially, the hoodoo traditions. Those reflect the old-fashioned system better than others, but even they have changed out of recognition in many ways, because people are always adding things and thinking, well, this other place like India has all these other answers. Well, we'll put that into the soup and mix it all up. And so, as time goes on, culture just rolls along and takes them with it.
Yeah. Now, you cite Owen Davis on his Cunning Folk, and he says that, you know, people consulted Cunning Folk because they provided explanations and solutions for the many misfortunes that occurred in their daily lives, as well as holding out the prospect through the attainment of love and money. You know, I know a couple of, I think, Cunning Folk, and they do, you know, this is what happens still today. You know, you will find these cunning women or cunning men, and they attain to the basic needs of humanity, which is basically health, wealth, money, love. You know, this is all that we need to be happy, isn't it? That's what...
Yes, I think the thing here yeah. is that the needs of people have not changed. It's part of the human nature.
Yes.
And, but we don't control our destinies or the world or anything else as much as we would like. And so this has always been something that you could add. You could try to enforce a little continuity of your own interests against what seemed like fate or providence or any of these other overwhelming patterns that you didn't find comfortable with what you're doing. And so people have always tried to look for that. They've always tried to figure out what the future is going to be, you know, how is it going to treat me, and then try to manipulate it to suit their own needs. And it's a perfectly human thing, and exists everywhere, as you said.
Now, the other thing, it's very interesting now, going into divination, which is one of the things that, you know, well, it's like very old.
Yes.
Just tell me, you know, Delphi, just tell me my future, or please advise me on the destiny, or please advise me on what is going to happen so that I can make better choices. And this is, you know, still today, people are going to, you know, oh, tarot readings or something else. And they do these things. But then we go into the divination, and we go a little bit deeper, because it was a little bit more complicated than that, wasn't it? Because they begin to say, okay, who stole my horse?
Yes, it's practical questions. Back in the time the Cunning Folk were functioning, it's because they didn't have any other avenue to do so. Now, during the Middle Ages, and probably in Catholic countries today, the Church sometimes provides some of these functions, save you against evil witches, or, you know, trying to figure out who stole your horse in a day when there are no police, there's no FBI, there's no vehicle for doing for ordinary people, and this is what they came up with. And the cunning men often were very good at this. They knew what was going on in their community. They had their ear to the ground. They had their informants, you might say. And putting that together along with their sincere faith in the stars or whoever was controlling things, because something had to be controlling things. Why did they happen the way they did? And so you would do these spells either to protect yourself or to, you know, find out who stole your fish or who stole...
Yeah, divination. So one of the things that I really, really like here in your book, it's, of course, the thing that you actually did, you know, you clarified, okay, let's just look at the actual methods, you know, let's get the methods out. And one of the, one of my favorites is, I have seen a couple of them. One of them is... with the Bible, it's called the Key and Book Charm, which is one of the that I knew of about, and the book, of course, will be the Bible. But then you have here the Wheel of Fortune, which is very interesting. How did this work? The Wheel of Fortune is it's a very interesting method that I never seen before.
It was very common. It turns up in all sorts of forms. It was the idea that it is one of the ways to capture the instant of time and therefore figure out what is going to happen by whatever hidden forces are at work. And it goes all the way back to, you know, Greco-Roman times, and turns up not only in the big manuals, but also it turns up in the little, you know, cheap handbooks and almanacs and things like that. So the Wheel of Fortune was one of the ways of the same thing with the book or the Seven Shears, which is actually found all around the world. of trying to capture the moment. And by capturing the moment in divination, you are able to define the future. And so you follow the directions of the Wheel of Fortune and pick out your numbers and do your interpretation and look up the answer. And it like all oracles, it is puzzling, but it tries to cover everything, yes.
Did you ever try any of these? Because these are very interesting. I mean, at least the divination ones, they're very, you know, did you try any of these little... researched methods.
The only thing I ever tried before I got interested in the subject in general was astrology, and I got very good at it. And you know, for instance, I was able to predict to the woman that came to me and wanted a chart and what was going to happen. Well, I more or less told her she was going to get pregnant by somebody in the J. Giles band, and she was. And at the time, she said, "Oh no, it's impossible. I know these people, but that's it." And then later it came true. But having gone through and basically done shots for a lot of my friends, I sort of satisfied myself that that's how it works. And I've never much tried other things. I just don't have the need for them. Unlike people who are insecure in what they're doing, I always find that things always seem to work out, so I don't worry about it. But I'm fascinated with the fact that when people are trying to control their lives, these are the things they turn to.
Very good. Yes. That is true. That is true. And you know, necessity. You know, sometimes you know, people just. I've seen you know people, and then so let's talk about money here, right? Mm. So there's always some kind of exchange, right? In these favors, right?
Yes. you know, people often say they didn't charge for things. Well, as in the one about like. Old Johnny, which is one of the cunning men's careers that I mentioned.
Yes.
He would say, "Oh, there's no charge." And if somebody takes him literally, he gets really pissed. The thing was that, yes, this was a service provided, and you paid for the service, as was suitable and fitting. And sometimes it was very inexpensive, and sometimes it was for free. That was because people got the pleasure of helping people, and also the you know, social reputation for being wiser than everybody in the neighborhood. So it could be for status, but it could also be for cash.
Absolutely. Because sometimes that's what, oh, I remember what we were talking before, and what I wanted to tell you is that you said that there was sometimes a little bit of a mixture between what they knew. In other words, the cunning, right? So
yes.
What they knew around them, because they were very much, you know, aware of their own surroundings and, you know, politics, etc. And also on, you know, you said, you know, a very sincere faith on whatever, you know, stars or whatever it was. So it was a mix of the two. They were actually very clever. There were some that were a little bit more clever than others.
Yes.
So in your opinion, what does really define a cunning man or a cunning woman, in this case, in a cunning man, you know?
Yes, I think what it is it has to be somebody who is going beyond just the daily life and agricultural communities, a small craftsman or whatever else they might be doing, teaching or even preaching. They're curious about how things work, and they are ambitious. They come above their class by stepping outside. They're what you might call liminal characters. They exist on a balance between normal life and the supernatural, or preternatural, as they would say back then. Mm-hmm. And having done this, they more or less are all self-taught. There's a few that seem to learn from other people, but mostly they get so curious. It's just like people who take up occult today. I mean, it doesn't pay particularly well. It does give you status if you wish it. And but they have a curiosity that goes beyond people who are perfectly satisfied to live in the materialistic world.
Yeah,
and
that's
so
true.
Having decided to take this path and train themselves in this business, they then take up the career of it. And one thing that always has surprised me is that we don't have any memoirs of people who did this, you know, to any great extent. Since the last of the cunning folk probably lived into the 20th century, you'd think somebody would remember them, or somebody would actually say, "Oh yes, my grandmother actually did this, and that's how they, you know, how they work." But those kind of memoirs, I never turned up any. in my research. It's fascinating.
That's very interesting. You know, do you count, you know, the for instance, the evil eye as a cunning man's, you know, activity or not? You know, to take the evil eye out, you know, that's very European.
Oh, absolutely. It's just the same thing as, you know, the black witches, the evil witches. It's a supernatural threat, and therefore one of the things that you go to somebody who's expert in these sort of things is to deal with things that are in this other world, the otherworldly way of looking at things. And, you know, if you feel somebody has given, you know, the evil eye, you either get some charms that your aunt told you about, or you go to a practitioner and say, I want this taken off me. I think it's so-and-so did this. And then they do their little ritual, and you feel much better about it.
Well, most, you know, sometimes, you know, it's very it's just impression, and it's how you do it. You know, if you stick a cow's tongue in someone's door, bleeding, you know, and dropping blood in their forestep, even if you just do that, it is sufficient to make them believe that they are actually, you know. So, psychosomatic, you know, could ensue, you know, into this person, say, the thinking that they were actually cursed. Right? So these also are very, very interesting things, you know, imagery. How did they feel? How, you know, it's just a pinning a doll full of pins. Even if it is just a little doll full of pins without anything into it, the image of it was recognized. Now, was this something that you felt that was also across the board, that people at the time would recognize, you know, of course, considering all of the habitus and all of that, but they would recognize this magical imagery, that they would know that this was active,
yes,
you know,
absolutely.
Cunning man.
You know, and you get the, mostly it's against witches or curses and things like that, and, you know, they've found lots of bull's hearts stuck with thorns or pins, and, you know, witch bottles with the bellamine jugs that have pins and urine and stuff like that in them. Everybody knew this. You didn't even have to go to a professional to do it. Everybody could tell you, oh, in that case, you do this. And they'd all heard it. Everybody knew about it. But if you maybe didn't trust yourself to have this much influence, you went to somebody who you knew could do it. It felt better if it was done by an outside party, I think.
Yes. Yeah. No. Absolutely. Absolutely. You do it, and then it was also that dichotomy about, you know, I will go there and I will pay somebody to do this work for me, and that way I can just be, you know, my conscience will be okay to go to the church on Sunday. I won't be able to be. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think part of it is pushing the any guilt there might be, but I don't think they really felt guilt. They just wanted it done, but they wanted it done by, you know, it's like going to a regular, you know, expensive hospital rather than just some country doctor. In this case, you know, you want the best result, so you go to somebody you feel that you can trust, and you put all their trust in them. I don't know if you have any guilt about it, but
Was there? I think there was one of the, you know, in the witch trials, 1692. There was someone in Salem, a woman actually, that paid a witch, or a cunning man, or a cunning woman, to actually make a charm against witches, and she was not trialed for it, which is very interesting. I don't remember her name. I think it was Mary Seepley, that was the woman who actually did that. Interestingly enough, and she was never charged for it, and she did that. She was quite healthy, wealthy, I think, and she did it. She actually played.
This was part of their culture, and you know, if you wanted this done, there's always been, even in Puritan New England, somebody who's willing to do it. Sometimes they would do it just because they like the person involved, you know, and they might get paid too. But I think the thing is that it's something that, you know, it's not just you know, the 92 Salem, but it's people like Moll Pitcher, not the revolutionary Moll Pitcher, but the cunning woman Moll Pitcher lived up there on the North Shore. And because there is definitely a demand for this sort of thing, there's a few people always willing to take it up despite the legal dangers. And as I say in the book, I mean, people keep saying, oh, the cunning men and wise women were burned as witches. No, they weren't. Very few of them ever came to trial. The neighbors thought of them as a beneficial thing, and they were put in a separate category, absolutely separate. The Puritans and us today might call them both witches, but to them, one is a positive practitioner, and the other is a more or less invisible threat, and they're two different categories.
Now, there is a huge list of things that you have here. There's cures for everything, including for a large neck, which is a goiter. That's the sign of the little was goiter, but headache, heartburn, inflammation, hydrophobia, hernia. I mean, you have all sorts of things. Itch. It doesn't matter. Healing. So this was the healing part of it. But one of the most fascinating things here is, and we've heard this before, of objects that are consecrated or imbued with some kind of power. We had that sometimes the monks would do a little thing, sometimes a little curse, if you steal this book, you will lose your hands. But there is other things, like, for instance, the Carmelite monks, which I thought that was so cute. It's Sweet Notes. It was called Sweet Notes.
Billet
doux. The billet doux. So Sweet Notes. And they would do these little formulas on consecrated paper, and they would put and bury them in the corner of a field against or to give protection against bad weather and disturbing or insects or whatever it is. And then you have all of the things how you do this, which... it might serve somebody, but it really is very interesting. All of these objects that had, magical powers, and they're imbued with magical powers. How were these objects done? I mean, would you just, pray over them or consecrate? Did you find out how did they consecrate these?
Yes, well, that's actually in the book about how the conception billets are done and how there's curses as well. But the whole point here is that if, you're in a Christian culture and therefore everything comes from God, then if you can just turn a little bit of God's power to your own uses, and probably the best example, but it doesn't fit in what I wrote, is the idea of the relics. Relics of saints were considered to have power. You went and went to and touched a bone that the saint had, his arm bone or something on that line. And these were put in beautiful gold and crystal containers, reliquaries, and this kind of thing. In fact, if you even took a cloth and rubbed it, then the cloth became magic in a sort of contagious way. In other words, you're simply channeling what you considered a divine force, and the church used to have some of these, the Agnus Deis, for example.
Yes, the Agnus Deis.
And made from the paschal candles.
Yes.
And those were available. It was a competition to the cunning folk, but once the Puritans got rid of all that stuff, then, all you had left was what the cunning folk could do for you. And but the idea that this power is floating around and can be channeled and channels automatically into the bones of saints is something that every pious Christian of the time believed in. It isn't hard to therefore transfer a little of that same concept to other things.
Now this, I'm thinking about, for instance, places of power or places, sacred places, Christianity sacred places. I mean, you have relics all over, but you also have ground, holy ground, that people just by stepping on it will be imbued by some kind of, either healing power or whatever. Let's talk about morals here. and the curse versus the blessing. Which, in my opinion, is a different blessing, way of blessing. A curse is a different way of blessing.
It's sort of other side of the coin. Yeah.
Yes, that's right. Were there any morals?
Yeah, there's definitely a moral effigy to, you know, efficacy to all this.
Yes.
They had to do it right. They, you know, in all of the magic of the time, you still had to purify yourself to become less worldly, to, you know, you had to bathe, which wasn't always the easiest thing in those days. You had to make yourself ready, just as a saint had to make himself ready to, you know, provide some sort of exorcism or things like that. And so if you weren't moral in some fashion, and how they got around the details is sort of fascinating, then it wouldn't work. And therefore, in order to deal with a holy power, you had to become somewhat holy yourself. You had to sort of mimic what was necessary. And
yeah,
so the
yeah.
same things that priests would do to prepare themselves for religious rites were the same things magicians did to prepare themselves for necromancy.
Yes. Now, the beautiful thing about this book, Jim, is that you can see the very simple charms and blessings and all of these things in the beginning of the book. And as you go further into it, you will begin to see that the cunning folk begin to be, or what they did, begin to be more and more and more complex. And you begin to see that they begin to use astronomy, they begin to use things from the stars, you know, auspices, hours, things. And then you go into conjurations, and conjurations were actually very simple in the beginning. Now they're turning into long and length conjurations with a lot of names of power that, of course, you know, will include a lot of names of God. But now you have a little bit more of a, you know, a little bit more of a, something more complex, and we're dealing with spirits, we're dealing with exorcisms and fairies and demons, which you know sometimes are very interchangeable. But it's very interesting to see this evolution, which almost goes to and then you have sacred symbols, and you have like the all of these sigils and things like that. So then they had very simple tools in the beginning, was just the paper or maybe, you know, something, some herb or something. Now you have like special tools, like, you know, sacred knives and things like that with things inscribed in them and all of that. So did it get more and more complex?
Actually, no, the book does, but those all existed simultaneously. It's hard to do anything that doesn't show that. But they all existed simultaneously. It's like all of ritual magic is basically a function of the exorcist's power. And in order to make this work, you had to sort of accumulate this power, which I call virtus in the book.
Yes.
And you brought as many things in together that would have it. It's like putting more and more batteries or more and more current into what you were doing. And that is something that, as you got into more demanding and complicated things to do, you had to have more and more virtus on your side, you might say, or lined up. And it goes back to the concept of, like I said, of exorcism. And to do this, if you were working with astrological virtus, which I think is a central feature of the whole thing, if
yes.
anything is,
mm-hmm.
You go back to Ficino, and Ficino takes this very carefully, and in his third book of the, you know, the his book on the books of life, he tells you how to gather all of this power together and how to use it. And he does it for healing, but it's just as easily done for other uses as well. But if you're going to exorcise somebody, you've got to get all the power on your side. And they did that with objects and also, of course, with sacred names.
Yeah, because these names were very, I mean, some of these names are very, there are strange names that I don't know if, I mean, were there classes of cunning men? Because, you know, it seems to me that there is like this very complicated, almost ecclesiastic, you know, kind of knowledge, and then there is like the simple the simpler yeah. people. The other thing that it's very curious also, Jim, is the treasure hunting, which is something that you see that you see everywhere. I remember that I bought a book in Portugal, very, very famous one, the Book of San Ciprian, and it had a big section on how to treasure hunt and how to find all of these treasures all across Portugal. Nobody found them, but but anyway, but the method was there. Was this also a practice in America?
Yes, in fact, there's a whole chapter on the, or a whole half chapter on the practice of treasure hunting in America. It came to America. And yet, in England, of course, or in Europe in general, it made sense because people are even today turning up hoards of coins and jewelry and stuff that have been buried either before an attack or somebody was trying to save the stuff and then didn't tell anybody where it was. And so I give examples of what they did in England. And it did come to America, and it was an actual fad around 1800, where people were doing this all over New England and New York and New Jersey.
Yes,
and
it
even bled over into what became the Mormon way of doing things, because Joseph Smith was a treasure hunter before he became a prophet. Mm. And treasure hunting, that's why I give it a separate chapter, because the treasure hunting system is so fascinating in itself that even the people who would, you know, this sort of thing was illegal, but if you were promised to pay some of the proceeds to the lords and kings, then they would license you for it. Like when William Lilly tried to find treasure in Westminster Abbey and was unsuccessful, but, you know, it straddled the line between, you might say, greed and theology.
Yes, yeah. Now, you do have a couple of other things here that are fascinating. One of them, it's an appendix. It's Appendix 2, and it's called White Witches.
Yeah.
An apology to Louise Ubner. What did you try to... I mean, this, you know, it looks to me that it's a very interesting appendix. It is about Wicca, and it is about modern... what they call it, the new religion, or Wiccan, the new religion. Why was this an apology?
Well, it's because Louise Hubner, I read her book, and when I was thought the what I consider the witch party line, you know, the whole what Gardner and everybody else had said, I thought, oh, she's, you know, mistaken, because she was doing very typical Italian traditional magic out there in Los Angeles, an official witch of Los Angeles, or whatever she was known as.
Mm-hmm.
And so I dismissed it, and I was amused that she'd got the story so wrong. And then I found out that she was actually an example of the real tradition, whereas the rest of this had been sort of cobbled together. And so I tried in that essay, which I wrote in 93, what I had been thinking for years about, well, what really was the historical case, and what did Gardner or whoever preceded him put together, and why? And, you know, try to explain how, since you can find just about everything in the Wiccan Book of Shadows in published sources available to Gardner at his time, that, you know, plus a few things written new, but it was like, this is the real history, and it is different from what I had originally thought. And I thought, well, Louise was right. You know, she was actually more honest about it than some of these other people. So I had that was published because somebody asked me to do it. And I never did get paid or anything for it. They even didn't send me the book. They sent me a wrong book.
Really?
I had to buy one. Yes, which I found a little annoying.
Oh, goodness.
But I'd given this as a talk to some people at one of these meetings, conferences, and got hooted down by people who believed that, you know, the Wiccan party line was true, and this was a lot of nonsense on my part. And so I thought, well, I will put in the footnotes, and that's what I was doing. That had been worked for many years in this 30-year process. The actual composition of the handbook only took about 2.5 years.
But it's a very interesting article if you're listening to us right now. It's Appendix 2. It's called White Witches. Very, very good. Now, Jim, what did you learn you know, from the you know, the did this satisfied you in terms of answering the question that was that prompted you to write this book? Were you satisfied with this?
Yes, I was. Actually, I had come to the conclusions that I have in the book, except for the analysis of the evolution and how things are supposed to work, which I had to work up for the book itself.
Yes.
I had more or less traced the historical roots to my own satisfaction, and I didn't know if I'd ever get around to writing it down. But then I thought, after reading the various things like Davies or Hutton, that these are fascinating histories. They cover the thing beautifully, except anybody who's reading them who hasn't done the research I have, or the research they did, is still left in the dark about what actually went on. And so I thought, that's what's needed. That's the place I can make a contribution.
I have my favorite, and I don't know if it is because I'm from Portugal, and of course this is still done today. And I don't know, at the time, I don't know if you maybe you do know this, but you are not supposed to write it down. The prayer that it said in the evil eye removal, you're supposed to listen to it, and as you listen, you will listen one and twice and thrice and, you know, many times, and then that's the way you will memorize it. So from the mouth of another doing it and observing them doing it. So they were not supposed to write it down, or, you know, yeah, and you only learn by looking at it and listen to it more than, I don't know, 20 times more, you know what I mean? That's how it was passed on. But it's very interesting because my favorite spell here on, or charm here on your book is precisely that. It's overlooking on, or the evil eye, and it is a spell for evil eye. It's very, very interesting. Do you have a favorite one that you said, oh, this is very interesting? I mean, you have so many in here, but that you said, oh, I didn't know that that could be, you know.
I think for the most part, no, I mean, that's an interesting thing, the fact that you have to keep it oral.
Yes.
That's the stuff that's, you know, many times it's been lost.
Yes.
At least
yeah.
in you know, since modern occultism got into theosophy and everything went, or mesmerism and all that stuff got pushed out, and people were not, training down. And yet, even though they say that, nearly everywhere you can find these things written down, because somebody would write them down, usually somebody who didn't like it, but
yeah, that's right.
nearly everything is eventually in some form recorded, and it's like the opposite side, that unless you're a book learning, even if you're illiterate, you had to pretend you were literate, because that's where the secret knowledge obviously lay.
Yes.
So there's different ways of looking at it.
Oh dear.
And my mouth is getting dry.
Oh, sorry.
Yes, no, there is obviously conflicting, or, you know, these run parallel.
Mm-hmm.
You can only learn it orally from a teacher, maybe of the other gender and things like that.
Yes, yeah.
Simultaneously, you can only do it if it's been recorded in a big, mysterious book. I mean, the books of those times, the magical books, were themselves consecrated and considered to have power in themselves,
yes,
as objects, as well as being recipes for how to do things.
Yes. Yeah.
And so it depends on, the power will fade if you don't do the things right. Sometimes it's oral, sometimes it's written.
Absolutely. This is very interesting because I know of some cunning folks back in Portugal, and some people that actually still practice this today, and that's the, you know, some of the things are passed orally only. You can't, you know, there is no little book or anything like that. But other things are, yes, and of course, yeah, the books were imbued. That's right. Yeah, yeah. So you don't have a favorite one, do you?
No. I've got so many. I couldn't pick out any one particular one that I find more fascinating. I think the one that got me most interested, though, was the one on scapulomancy. You know, the
yes.
using the the shoulder blade of a sheep to predict the future.
Yes.
Because I'd always heard about that. And until I found an author who had actually gone in and detailed this, I always thought, well, that's something to know about. Because often in books about history of magic, you see a whole series of terms, you know, you can tell fortunes by fire, by water, by earth. They won't tell you anything about how to do it. But that one survived long enough to actually get details, and that I was very pleased to find.
Very good, yeah, yeah. And also the way that they engrave these talismans and things, that was also done in a certain way, under certain auspices, etc., etc. So did anything, if it could be possible, of course it is, but went unpublished on this book that you said, oh, damn it, I already sent it to Avalonia, I can't really put this in?
Yes, I haven't stopped reading. And every now and then, of course, a lot of things didn't go in anyways. It would have been much longer if I'd put all the stuff I'd found in. I had to be very selective, even to keep it down to 550 pages in that tiny print that they decided to use.
Yes.
There's much more. All I could do was samples, because I suppose if we did it fully, you'd have to republish all of the sources I used.
Yes, that's true.
Reprint the whole, 24 volumes or whatever it might be of different sources. Each one, like when I talk about, say, palmistry, I only take an example, a full example is possible, but the books I took them from are much longer. So, and then there are other examples I thought, well, that would have been nice if I had run across it or remembered it, because when you're trying to balance all this stuff in your mind, you forget stuff.
Absolutely, yes, yes. Ladies and gentlemen, we're talking with Jim Baker, the author of The Cunning Men's Handbook, published by Avalonia Books. And this has been a fascinating conversation. Jim, thank you so much for sitting on the black chair. I don't know if you're sitting on a black chair, but, the black chair is the seat of wisdom.
Blue.
Oh, it is blue? Okay, that's fine. So thank you so much for being on the black chair and accepting our invitation and be so so generous with us with all of these wonderful discoveries on your book. And are you going to do more, or is this it for the Cunning Folk?
It's probably that's it for the Cunning Folk.
Okay.
It would just be more of the same. I might do something else sometime, but I haven't figured out what would be a real contribution.
Mm-hmm.
Or in those other areas, I don't really know how to approach mm-hmm. subjects, mm-hmm. but such as how modern conjuration has been changed, especially with things like chaos magic, which
yes.
I find very curious.
Yes, very interesting.
But, I like history and tradition, and therefore I was more or less stuck to that end of things.
Very good, very good. Well, thank you so much, Jim, for being with us and giving us this wonderful conversation.
Very good.
Thank you very much.
You.
So
very good, yeah.
This is it for our show. I will talk to you next week with more on the Black Chair. Until then, have a wonderful week. Bye-bye.